Now, the original building that was built on the site was built as a slaughterhouse. It was built back in 1850. It ran as a slaughterhouse from 1850 until the early 1890s, and then the business closed down. The building remained vacant until the early 1900s, and then they tore it down. But in the time that the building remained vacant, people were sneaking into the basement of that building and using the well that's still down here for satanic ritual. I guess they figured since so much blood was dumped down into the well all the years it was a slaughterhouse, it'd be a perfect place to try to open up a portal directly to hell itself by doing ceremonies and sacrifices at the well. Some people believe they succeeded at it, and others not so much. After the building was torn down, another little building was built over what was left of the foundation, opened up as a general store, saloon type business, known as the Bluegrass Inn. Actually, this wall right here is the outside wall of that original little building. And that ran until the 1920s, then when Prohibition started, they converted it into a speakeasy brothel downstairs. That ran until the 1930s. Then a man by the name of E.A. Brady, everybody called him Buck Brady, he came in, bought the property, tore the first floor of the building off, left the bottom half down here, and used it as added support, and built everything you see upstairs all around it, and fixed it up really nice, had a casino added into it, which is now the ballroom, and it opened up as the Primrose. Now, the Primrose ran until 1947 and was doing such an amazing business it actually caught the attention of the mob, which was prevalent down here in Newport at the time. Well, the mob came up, pushed their way into the business, ran Buck Brady out of town, and took it over. When they did, they changed it from the Primrose to the Latin. Now, Latin Floor ran through the late 40s, 50s, and 60s, and finally it was forced to close down due to gaming wall changes and all the other illicit activities going on because the mob was running it. Because Newport was finally starting to claim everything back and taking control away from the mob and running them out. After they went out, there was a Hard Rock Cafe here for a little while. Not the Hard Rock everybody knows and loves. This was sort of like a roughneck biker bar. City of Waller came down, forced them to close down because the last year that they were open, they had six murders out here in the parking lot and fights and stabbings going on in the bar to the point it was just getting out of control. Finally, the city said, look, enough's enough, you're done, shut it down. After they went out, the building was empty for another year and a half, and then Bobby bought it in 1978. It's been his ever since. It's his history. The noise you heard there was our local spirits, believe it or not. Now, actually, this pipe right here, and that pipe back over there, those are beer bottle chutes from the bar upstairs.
I was just thinking it was the vibrations from all the stompings.
When they collect all the empty beer bottles, they take them to the bar and there's chutes there on the floor and they just drop them in and go down and drop into the barrels. It keeps them from building up behind the bar.
That's smart.
But even though you know what it is, it'll still get you because you're
not expecting it.
You never know when it's going to happen. So now if you'll follow me, we'll head back down this way. Supper club type businesses where you can come in, sit down, order a nice meal while you're enjoying your meal, watch a show, be it dancing, singing, whatever. All these rooms down through here were all dressing rooms for the dancers to come down, get ready for their shows, hang out in between shows, smoke cigarettes, drink drinks, kick back, relax. Who knows what else they really want. This room here was Johanna's dressing room. Didn't approve of the relationship to begin with. When he found out what they were going to do, he did what all good fathers would have loved. to have done back in those days, and had him killed. Now, Johanna was so distraught over the fact of losing her lover, but then to find out her father was behind the whole thing, she ended up poisoning her father and then herself. Now, her father did survive the poisoning, but unfortunately, her and her unborn child did not. Now, claims of activity going on in here, people claim that her hair pulled on, clothes tucked on, a lot of EVPs, the voices claiming to be Johanna have been caught here. People have been up near and out of the corner of their eye, claim they see her look like a woman standing next to them, and they'll turn and look real quick, and there's nobody there. Some people have taken pictures of the back wall where the mirror is, and have on occasions caught images in the mirror other than themselves. We had one gentleman took a picture caught in the middle, in the mirror, it looked like somebody hanging from the center of the room with a noose around their neck. And that's how they believe they killed Robert Randall. We also keep roses back around the counter to symbolize the fact that she did love the smell of roses. It was her favorite flower, and she always wore rose-scented perfume. People have claimed they've smelled the strong scent of roses up in the bar when the bar is closed. People have also smelled the strong scent of roses on occasion here as well. Bobby, when he first bought the place, brought his oldest daughter and was showing her around the building, saying, you know, I'm going to make this a ballroom. I'm going to make this a billiard room. I'm going to knock this wall out so you can see all the way across the bar. Just showing her the different things he planned for the building. When they got done, they went back outside. He goes, well, what do you think? She goes, never went back in that building again. And Bobby said, well, why not? She says, I felt like I was in a funeral home. I could smell roses like they were on parade. So I felt like I was being watched, and I just not comfortable in there. She would not step back into this building. It took her 20 years before she finally came back through the door. She doesn't feel too much of it anymore, but it freaked her out.
Yeah.
10 years ago, I had a tour down here, and we were in here talking about Johanna. We started smelling roses in here really heavily. Well, first I thought, okay, somebody brought in some spray, you know, let's mess with everybody. Hey, I smell roses. So I kind of laughed it off in my mind, somebody playing games. But then back in that corner, we started getting a cold spot. It's like sticking your hand in a freezer. It was that cold. This was the end of May, 1st of June. So the temperature in here was very comfortable. I thought, okay, you can fake the scent, but you can't fake the cold spot. Maybe she is in here. Maybe she's in here looking for a lover, trying to figure out what we're doing in here. We're just hanging out. Who knows? But the moment that cold spot disappeared, the smell was gone instantly. And I haven't had it happen since then. So that was kind of an interesting night. Like I was saying earlier, some people believe too that it may have been Johanna that brought the tablecloths out to the police officer and deny the accident up front because she didn't fit the description. I get excited once in a while when it happens. Well, I get excited every time that happens. If everything comes together just at the right moment, it may not happen for a year. It may happen 2 or 3 times a year. But if it comes to just everything in the right moment at that time, I'll be in here with a group on Johanna's story to the tour, and Bobby will be on stage right above us singing the song Johanna that he wrote about her, and it's coming down through the floor. I'm telling her story and he's singing her song in the background. It's kind of cool when it happens.
Yeah.
So now, if you'll follow me, we'll head back into the room of faces. All these rooms, every one of them is all pretty much set the same thing because they're all dressing rooms.
What's the writing on the mirror there?
People write on them all the time. When they do a like investigations, they're always in there writing on them. I think it's not that one. I think it's this one over here. This is the first. Of course, this one's so full of junk, but yeah, they not only wrote on the mirrors, they wrote on the walls and everywhere else. But yeah. No respect. Trash. Some of the old games, little
yeah.
That's awesome.
The old punching bag with the dial instead of the digital stuff.
I like the play at your own risks on the center of it there.
Yeah, people were always busting their hands, yeah. Wrists up, breaking fingers.
Yeah, every time I'd mess around at like the county fair or something, just goofing around with my friends, you know, I'd hit it, I feel like I'd break my hand, yeah. Or something.
Yeah. Oh, have you seen the movie Urban Cowboy?
Yeah.
With John Travolta. That's the bull from the movie.
This bull right here?
Yeah. Bobby bought it. Right when we were getting done filming the last scene, he was in the parking lot when he filmed the last scene. Still got the old Gilly sticker on there.
Nice.
Women go up there and they'll go, John Travolta's butt sat right here. And I go right behind him and go, Debra Winger's butt sat right here. They used to have it up at the ballroom. So many people were climbing all over it all the time to the point that he was afraid it was just going to get damaged. He'd get drunk and then climb it along.
Yeah.
So he just brought it down here so it wouldn't get torn up. Grayish mass I was telling you about that I'd seen down here when I was working one time. I think I was told you about that.
I don't remember a white grayish mask.
I was working in there one night by myself. Out of the corner of my eye, it seemed to look like somebody came up to the doorway. So I looked up to see who it was. And standing right here was this white grayish mass in the shape of a person. Huh. I looked at it for like 5 or 6 seconds, and all of a sudden it just shot off that direction. No footsteps, no sound, nothing. It was just, and it was gone. Come out, looked around, couldn't find anybody, wouldn't see nobody, nothing. Came back in, picked my stuff up. And that was pretty cool. Went back to work. But that was one of the experiences I've had from being here.
I would love to experience something like that. Or anything. Anywhere.
Okay, this room here is known as the Room of Faces. The reason they call it the Room of Faces is obviously people look all over the walls and see what they believe to be faces. Some people see them, some people don't. Wanda Kay, that used to be our DJ here, she always called that one the George Bush face. She goes, looks like George Bush to me. Looks like a monkey to me, but you know.
Yeah.
Monkeys, politicians, you can't tell the difference anymore. Another one here looks like somebody's looking up at the ceiling and screaming.
Yeah, I can see it.
His mouth.
Yeah.
I call that one E.T. because it kind of looks like an alien's face. The creepy clown. And the most prominent one doesn't have much of a face in it, but it has more, looks more like a woman laying in bed with, partial woman laying in bed with her head on a pillow. And that's right here. The white part's the pillow.
I see it.
The dark part's her hair. Her head.
Yeah.
Her chin, her neck, her shoulder. Her arm hanging down. You see the strap of her dress going over her shoulder, and then her dress and body just kind of fade off into the wall. But it's kind of like she's laying there in bed dead. Or she passed out because she drank too much. I mean, we are in a bar, right? Some people believe it's just the way the concrete was poured when it cured, caused all these shades in the wall. People look at the shades and believe that they see these faces. And that leads to why we also call this room a matrixing room. Because matrixing is like looking at a picture. It's a chaotic mess. You're trying to find something in that picture that makes sense to you. And the most common thing to the human mind is a face. And that's why it's so easy to pull one out of something, mm-hmm. even when there's not really one there. That's like when I see pictures, people taking pictures of the outside of a house. And they say, look, you can see a face in there. Especially if it's when there are reflections of trees behind them shining, you know, reflecting on the windows.
Mm-hmm.
And they'll look at these and they'll say, you just get a face, you know. So, to me, it's matrixing. I don't believe there's a face there.
Yeah.
You know, it looks like there is, but I don't believe there is. It's kind of like laying out in the backyard looking up at the clouds. You know, there's a kitty cat. There's a kitty cat. There's my ex-wife's brother's boyfriend. That's all on the scientific side of it. Now, on the spiritual side of it, they did bring multiple psychics and mediums down here, and they all did their thing on the walls, the old doors, the shelving, the whole complete room. And every one of them come back saying the same thing, that these were all faces and souls of the people who were tortured and died in this room. Factoring Latin Quarter days, if somebody accumulated a large gambling debt and couldn't pay it back, or he caught him stealing or cheating in the casino, they'd bring him down into this room and beat on him and torture him. If they still wouldn't comply to what they wanted, you most likely ended up killing them. You just didn't mess with the mob's money or their business. They liked this room the best because it's the most insulated room in the building. You have a thick wall in that direction with the sidewalk and street up there. There's a marble floor over top of us. And then these three walls here, as you can tell by looking at the door frame, are over 3 feet thick. So they could scream and yell and holler all they wanted, and nobody would hear them. Claims of activity going on in this room is like Johanna's dressing room, hair belongs, EVPs and such. But people have also been pushed, shoved, smacked, punched, grabbed, pinched, touched, and on occasions caressed. Haven't had that one happen yet. One of these days it's going to happen. I'm hoping. Some people have claimed that they've seen a full-bodied apparition of a child in this room. So we do have some child spirits here, because back during the slaughterhouse days, they did have children working in the slaughterhouse, mainly because they were small enough to get up in the machinery and make repairs the adults couldn't get to. They may have gotten killed in the machinery, or they may have been out in a corral where the animals were at. Something spooked an animal, it knocked them down, stomped them to death. That's why you'll see the toys sitting around here, because when the groups come in to do investigations, they'll use the toys as trigger items to try to communicate with the children. We did have one group called a Class A EVP of a child saying, I like bicycles. So the group actually brought them a little bicycle in there and left it for them as a momentum to them to say, hey, we heard your voice, we heard what you said and what you like. This bike's for you, which I thought was pretty nice of them. Yeah. And I know you guys do investigations, right?
Not really.
Not really?
No.
I thought you guys might have done investigations.
I go to places, but I've never done an investigation.
This is my first time. I'm just here for the ride.
Well, there you go. Well, you don't watch many of the shows either. That's kind of killing the whole next body.
Overnight Channel on YouTube, and
they'll do the same thing. It's the same thing. As if you were watching
BuzzFeed Unsolved.
They go in these places, they trip over things, bump into stuff. They're always talking about how dark it is, and they say the only reason you're seeing what they're seeing is because you're seeing through their night vision. Like, I use them as an example because everybody knows them, Ghost Adventures. Zach always tells Aaron to turn the night vision off so you can see what they're seeing. Of course, you're sitting in your living room, it's all lit up, all you see is a black TV screen, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But this is what it's like when you're actually getting in there and doing an investigation.
Yeah, it's pretty dark.
Pitch black.
Yeah.
So you can see why they bump into things, trip over stuff, and walk into door frames as they're going from room to room. Because I've done a lot of investigations in private homes and businesses and places. And it's some of the investigations, when I got done the next morning, I looked like I'd been tied to the back end of a pickup truck and drug around the field for 3 hours. Because you're running into everything, getting cuts, bruises, and what have you. So it gets pretty dark. Plus, it's kind of funny too. I'll have a big group and they're all spread out. I'll turn the light out. When I turn the light back on, there's these little huddle groups of people grabbing hold of each other. Or what I like to do to some of them, if I know they're really freaked out, or I'll have the light out and turn the light out, you know, and it's still out. And I go, okay, well, tour's over. See you later. And I start walking to the door and They're freaking out.
That's hilarious.
That was kind of fun. So now if you'll follow me, we'll head into the well room.
Yes.
Now this little room here is the old jail cell. And if you want to step up in there, feel free to do so.
Wait, in the sense of the overnight channel, you have to knock three times and introduce yourself. My name's Mary.
What?
Fine, I'm the only one that did it.
Okay.
Okay.
My name's Eric.
Yes.
You already know who I am.
Yeah, this is Mark.
That's cool. You ain't figured me out in 13 years. You better quit.
Yeah.
But this is the old jail cell.
There's my ball. Yeah, I saw that.
Back during, but there used to be a metal bar gate here.
Yeah.
It locked here, and then the hinges have all fallen off over the years. One broke here, and one was here, and the other was down at the bottom. But if somebody, back during Latin Quarter days, if somebody accumulated a large gambling debt but was going to pay it back, they didn't have the money on them at that moment, they would lock them up in here until a friend or relative or somebody could down pay the money so they wouldn't skip town. Sometimes they would, if they were after something from somebody and they weren't giving it to them or getting what they wanted or whatever, they would have to kidnap somebody, hold them in here until they got what they wanted from whoever it was they wanted it from. Some people have stepped up in there and felt sick to their stomach and uncomfortable, come back out and feel fine. Turn right around, go back up in there and feel sick to their stomach again, come back out and feel fine. Could it be something paranormal affecting them? It's a possibility. But you got to flip that coin over and look at the other side. Who's to say it's not a small case of claustrophobia they realize they don't have, and that's affecting their body that way.
Right.
You can't just automatically say, oh, it's spirits and ghosts. And, you know, you got to be objective and
got to play every
angle. Yeah, you got to look at everywhere thing. Some people have claimed they've seen a full-bodied apparition of somebody hanging from this pipe up here. So some people believe this might have been where they hung Robert Randall, Johanna's lover, if they did kill him by hanging him.
Right here?
Yeah, this pipe right here. This metal one. Because you figure, and people say, well, it doesn't seem like it's very high. Well,
I mean, you don't really even need to be that.
You don't have to be high. You know, all you have to do is they put you on a chair or a stool, tie the rope around the pipe and around their neck, and just kick the stool out. They're, yeah. You know, they're not caring. I mean, they're not caring whether you dropped a certain length to snap your neck. They probably want you to die slow by suffocating and strangling to death. They're probably getting their kicks out of it because that's, you know, hey.
You know, mob things.
Yeah, it's one of them mob things. I came in here one night, was turning the lights on, getting everything ready for the night. I reached in the door, flipped the switch, looked around to see if there was any chairs, you know, sitting out in the middle of the floor from an investigation the week before or whatever. And I looked over this way and I seen a white line across the threshold of the floor. Of the doorway. So I walked over here and I'm looking at it and I thought, you know, great. You know, it's a line of salt across the doorway. I thought, oh, great. You know, what was they doing on one of these investigations? And then I looked in on the floor in there, and on the floor was a circle with a pentagram in it. I thought, oh, now I know what they were trying to do. At least they had enough sense to seal the door. But then I got to looking at the circle and the pentagram and I started kind of laughing because they done the circle and the pentagram in salt. You know?
That kind of defeats the purpose.
It's like calling people into your house for a party and you got the doors padlocked shut. It's like, duh. But I kind of laughed at that. Then over here we have Stairway to Nowhere. Some people like to call it the Stairway to Heaven, but the stairs go right up into the ceiling and stop. Well, back during Prohibition, there used to be a trap door at the top of the steps. When the place would get raided, they'd come down through the trap door run down the steps out through the basement and get away. And then reverse, they'd sneak the illegal liquor up the river through the basement, up the steps, and everybody got pretty well plastered. It's been long since sealed off, but if you were still able to go up through there right now, you'd be surprising guys with their unmentionables hanging out, because you'd end up in the middle of the men's restroom. But back in the day, that's where the main office used to be. People have claimed they've heard footsteps running down the steps and past them. There'd be nobody there to make the sound. Tonight, yeah, you would hear footsteps because the bar's open, people are walking around. This is when the bar's closed, you know there's nobody up there, and you're hearing them coming down the steps, not up above the steps. Mm-hmm. Myself, personally, I believe it's more of a residual type haunting. It's been happening whether you're here or not. It's not intelligence, it's not trying to get your attention. It's just doing its thing and
just
releasing
like
its
muscle memory.
Yeah, exactly. And it's probably was got people so scared from running down the steps not to get caught by the cops. That probably may have possibly imprinted it to the wood and the surrounding material. And of course, since we have the stairway to heaven here, we have to have the gateway or the portal to hell here. This is the well. It has been capped, one for safety reasons, two to keep the river from flooding up into the basement, and three to keep people out because the tunnel still runs out to the river, although most of it's pretty much collapsed nowadays. But it is still a 14-foot drop straight down underneath the cap. That's where they dumped the blood, the guts when the slaughterhouse was open. When the slaughterhouse closed, this is where they were dropping their offerings and sacrifices when they were doing their rituals. Now back in 1896, there was a woman by the name of Phil Bryan. She was the daughter of a rich farmer from Indiana. She met a man named Scott Jackson, and she ended up getting pregnant by him. When she was 5 months pregnant, he talked her into coming down to Cincinnati to get an abortion because they didn't want to keep the baby. Well, she came on down, and Scott Jackson and his best friend, Alonzo Walling, who were both dental students here at the time, couldn't find anybody to do the abortion for them because back then, you know, nobody did those things.
Hey, we're going back in time now.
Yeah, exactly. So, since they couldn't find anybody, they figured they'd try to do it themselves using their dental tools. Well, needless to say, they botched it up to the point she was bleeding profusely, screaming in pain. They didn't want to get in trouble for what they'd done to her, so they ended up killing her by cutting her head off. Now, they found her headless body about a mile and a half up the road from here in an empty field. And the only reason they were able to identify who she was is since she was from a rich family, she had that extra money to have custom shoes made. And the company made her shoes for her, like all their clients. They put a serial number and a logo in every pair they made. That's how they kept their records straight. Well, they caught Scott and Alonzo, and the whole time they had him incarcerated, and kept asking them what they did with the head, and they would never tell them. Even the day they were up on the gallows with a noose around their neck, they said, look, we'll give you leniency. We'll let you live. Just tell us where the head is. Well, they said they couldn't do it because if they did, it would bring the wrath of Satan down on them. So with those words being said, in fact, what went on at the well here was satanic worshiping. They believe, and finding the body as close as they did, even having a bloodhound follow a scent trail from the body to the slaughterhouse, and they themselves had ties to devil worshiping. They believe that they threw her head down into the well as an offering to Satan during one of these rituals. Now, they found the body on February 1st of that year. They hung him a year later on March the 20th. So if the head had been thrown into the well, it would have been washed out into the river by the spring floods that came up flush the tunnel out. But her head was never found. Now, their hanging was the last public hanging that was done here in Campbell County. And right before they hung him, Scott Jackson hollered out. He said, I'll be back. I'm going to haunt this area forever. Well, right after Bobby bought the place, his first wife, Janet, was up in the apartment above the bar, cleaning it, straightening up things. While she was up there, she said something grabbed her, pushed her to the top of the steps, heard a man's voice yell, get out, and then threw her down the steps. Now, she, too, was 5.5 months pregnant at the time, just like Johanna was when she committed suicide, just like Pearl was when she was murdered. Now, the whole time, of course, her and the baby, you know, were okay, but the whole time she was being attacked, she kept seeing a man's face. And later on, when she saw the article about Pearl Bryan's murder, she saw Scott Jackson's picture in that article, and she said, that's the face. That's the man I saw. Maybe that was his way of saying, hey, I'm still around. Maybe he went after her because she was 5 months pregnant. She was on this property. It reminded him of Pearl and what he went through after he killed her. He didn't like it and attacked her for it. That's a possibility, too.
That might be the most effective reason for me to get pregnant. Just so I can come back when I'm 5 months.
Yeah. There you go.
Hey, I'm one of those people, I'm like, anyone and everyone can do whatever they want to me. Just let me know so I can actually believe you're doing it.
Yeah.
For scientific purposes.
For science. And research.
There you go.
Demons, spirits, I don't care. Smack me around.
But you have the gateway to hell here. Stairway to heaven here. We're stuck in between the two, so what we do here determines which door we get. Door number one or door number two.
Number two.
I personally prefer door number one. But if your luck's like mine, I take that first step, catch my foot, trip and fall. And
number
catch
two sounds more like more fun.
Well, I did have a guy one night on the tour. He was so drunk, he fell over the railing, went down the head first, knocked himself out.
Wow.
That other guy said I
could
jump in. The first guy, the 9 o'clock guy, said he jumped in. Can I jump in?
Yeah, go. Yeah, you're more than welcome to go.
Hell yeah.
Hell yeah. He had those little balls sitting over there
barely
in the corner of them, on this, those bricks there. They kept going off. Two of the four kept going off.
Which ones? Where?
Right in that corner over there. He had them sitting on them bricks.
Oh, I didn't bring any balls with me. Only the ones in my pants. People who tell me to go to hell, eat your hearts out. Literally. Do it. I dare you.
Yep.
Hi.
She's gone. She's done.
All right, we're leaving.
Okay, I'm just going to...
When that little horn started to come out of her head. Yeah.
Oh, that happens every once in a while. I got to tuck it back in. Always said I had an express pass to hell, so I guess I found it.
You can go find a jackhammer and break the cap for you.
I wish I would have known that we were going to come here and I could have brought stuff with me. That's a different plate. So apparently there's more than one plate.
There's a couple of different plate designs.
Were they having a tea party with Satan?
No, actually some of that, well, you never know what they mean. Some of these plates that are around here are from back in the last 4 days. And they have a kitchen and food. He's back here straddling the fence. Practicing for getting on the bowl later on.
Yeah.
But luckily tonight we have door number three, so we can, I call this our like free pass for a night tour. But yeah, the guy was lucky he didn't break his neck when he fell down.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, he fell?
Not the one earlier.
Oh.
No.
The drunk guy.
He's lucky he didn't break his neck, but it was funny as hell to watch.
I bet.
I saw the word job. I was like, yeah.
I like how there's just a Bible here.
Don't touch it, you'll burn yourself.
Up about a month and a half ago. Somebody must have brought up on an investigation.
Yeah, you can't touch it, you might burn yourself.
Stuff after investigations. Well, this brings us back to kind of where we started, and this is where we do conclude the tour. I do want to thank you for taking the tour. I hope you enjoyed it.
Yes.
I hope I didn't bore you too bad.
No, it was fun.
And now I'll let you head back up, and you can manage your bottles to freak out the next group that I'm down.
I'll wait another 20 minutes or so.
There you go. But thank you very, very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
So, wait, are you just going to leave us down here?
Yeah.
No, we're going to get locked in.
He's like, no, come on.
I rocked Carl down here one time by accident. I got